All right. Shalom, Most High in Christ. Bless. Happy Sabbath to everybody tuning in. All praises to the Most High in Christ. You know, once again, make sure you folks are very much taking notes, writing down the scriptures, learning. Make sure you're very cognizant of what you are doing and why you're doing it. All right. There's a lot of you that's been reaching out. I can only imagine what's going on in all the other, you know, organizations. It's a lot of people waking up. And as you begin to wake up, you start to come out of the dizzy state of mind that you once were in. It was very dizzy, all right? The dizzy state of mind that you were once in may be Christianity, maybe Islam, all right? You might have been an atheist. You might have been a 5%, an Egyptologist. Whatever the case may be, you start to learn the Bible, and now you're supposed to change your life, okay? Today's topic, order of the house, and a little subliminal message underneath, I don't trust him to lead. I don't trust him to lead. A lot of you brothers gonna have to realize that a lot of ladies don't really trust you to lead. You have to realize another thing is that the so-called white man, what he has done is he has put insecurity out there to the women and to the men, but to women in general. And we make these statements all the time. It's the only thing you got to realize is if you a brother, if a police car get behind you, you're riding with your little wife or whatever the case may be, she has no confidence. She's just nervous. I don't know what. There's no confidence to be like, oh, you know what? I don't care who pull up behind us, or I don't care who pull up. He can handle it. Yeah. No matter how much they say, oh, I trust you. you're living underneath an illusion, man. Your power has been stripped completely from you. You don't even really know it. Only thing you know is sports. You know, video games or whatever case, whatever emotional soothing mechanism you have. That's it. Now, last night we was touching on you know, emotional sickness, and this kind of is part two to that. We touched on some things last night which should have really jarred mainly some brothers to understand how you have to rule and what you need to watch out for. All right. We touched on even in the fact how Elkanah's wife basically was sitting there in a sorrowful state of mind. Eli, the priest, even noticed it. Her husband should have noticed it off the gate, but he noticed it, noticed the vows and all kind of other stuff. And then we know that now that had to be rehearsed back to him for her, for the Most High to approve that blessing. So he had to know something, all right, at the end. But it's oftentimes what you're seeing is what's out of order is the man may find out things later. You're like the last to maybe even know something, all right? But that's all a part of this dark and cloudy day that we're in, okay? Now, oh, my goodness. We was debating this. I've been debating this little topic for a minute. But not the scriptures on it, but how to articulate something to folks and really let it resonate in your spirit, all right? It's very difficult. But what you folks out there that is not in the truth, what you don't really see behind the scenes when you come in here, just into the truth, you see brothers and sisters start to galvanize. Like, it's something different happening. You're supposed to come together. You're supposed to start, you know, gelling. And now knowledge starts to increase and everyone's moving on one accord. It's a beautiful thing. Do you see that in Christianity? It's an illusion. So, therefore, I said, well, you know what? We're going to have to suffer them on this Sabbath. It's about to be some pain in your face. JB, I'm waiting for you. You ain't gonna even start. You're probably gonna try now. You're gonna smile on this one. So what we're gonna do is do an exercise. We're going to run a succession of clips. I don't know if I can even take it. But you folks out there, put your comments in or whatever the case may be. But this, pay very close attention to the next, what is it, 5 or 6 clips we're about to run. Okay? I'll tell you when to eject off of each one of them, because I don't know. I was struggling. Run it. Uh-oh.
If I started naming names, we'd be here all day, but can you help me acknowledge my incredible team that put the entire conference together? And my husband, who is supporting me, my family, my father, who created an incredible legacy, my mother, who's my role model, my daughters are on the worship team, my sons are working in the store. This is like a thing. Okay. Chow. Get your Bible. Did y'all bring y'all's Bible? We got an app for that. That's all right. Can I tell y'all, this is my Bible. I won it in a spelling bee in 1996. I thought I lost it for a long time because, you know, I wasn't exactly reading my word. And and then I found it in a box in my parents' house. And so this Bible's special to me. That's why I don't have no app. I'm going to be in Revelation 12. Y'all scared? Did y'all know that Revelation doesn't have an S at the end? Wow, shocker. Been calling it Revelations all these years. But God, won't he do it? Revelation 12. I'm in verse 1. And it says, "Now a great sign appeared in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. Then, being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 diadems on his head. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth, to devour her child as soon as it was born. She bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and his throne. Then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Spirit of the living God, without you, I am nothing. I can do nothing, and I can say absolutely nothing to change a life. But with you, God, if you were to breathe into this room, I'm crazy enough to believe that you would give these women the strength that they need to change their worlds. I believe that if you would breathe in this room, if you would use my voice as your vessel, that generational curses would be broken, that depression would have to lift, that suicide couldn't have any power anymore. That's the kind of God I serve, and that's the kind of anointing that exists in this room. This is not random. It is not coincidence. The enemy has waged war on me since I was a little girl because of the women standing in this room. So I make a decree in front of heaven that you must have your way. In Denver, Colorado, nobody came this far to stay the same. God, if you don't do it, it cannot be done. Nothing is off limits to you. Reach down in the depths of our souls and pull out anything that isn't from you. And instead, leave nothing but your power, your spirit, your love, your grace, your restoration. So let there be no nerves, no anxiety, no fear. Only you standing tall in me, in Jesus' name, amen, amen. For those of you who like to take notes, my subject is wild woman. Wild woman. Y'all wild? What was that about? Y'all wild, child? Yes. Wild woman. In the early 2000s, there was this television show that came on NBC. And the television show was called Fear Factor. I tried to watch Fear Factor. The whole point of the show was that they would get people to do crazy things to confront their fears for like $50,000. And it didn't take very long for me to realize that I would have been disqualified from the show. I mean, first of all, I already don't have $50,000, so me eating a spider to get it, I don't know if that's my thing, you know? The thing is that they would have them do stuff like lay in a bed and let mice crawl all over them for $50,000. And first of all, you already know how.
I don't know why she read Revelation chapter 12. I did. When the Deacon Nathan said, it's a stall tactic. To read something, you believe that it's. Somebody probably was like, wow, she just hit that. Praise God. Hit his mic. Go ahead.
Check. Yeah, just like I was, like I mentioned to the elder, that's exactly what that was. I mean, she ran through that scripture real quick because obviously you can see it's some type of woman's conference. So she read a scripture that mentioned woman, which we know what that means. So what she did is read that scripture. And just like I told the elder, it's a stall tactic. She read the scripture, then went into this emotional prayer to try to get everybody hype. But you notice she did not even go and touch none of what she read. She started telling stories. Stall tactics. That's all it is.
Well, I still got more clips for him. Run another clip. We ain't hit nothing yet. She looks like she madness.
Break every yoke asunder. Break every yoke asunder. We give up everything. God, we give up lying. We give up backbiting. We bind the spirit in the house of God. Every backbiting demon, every tail-bearing spirit, take out the jealousy. Take out the envy. Take it out. Somebody say, take it out.
Shut it out. Take her out. Immediately. 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 But everybody in there, she's take it out. Take it out. The next step is coming. The Lord sow a seed. Everybody hype now. Oh, the Lord will take out your money. Take out your wallet. Take it out. But hopefully what you're seeing, you're going to start to see it. We got more clips. Don't worry. It should be a pattern forming, all right? We ain't read nothing yet. We are letting the folks in Christianity speak. Next clip.
The doctor said it don't very well may have to be because God said, I am Jehovah Rapha. I am your healer. I am your provider. your way in and your way out. I am Alpha and Omega. I am the beginning and the end. I am your corner when you're thirsty. I am your bread when you're hungry. Tell your neighbor, say neighbor, oh neighbor, ooh neighbor, I want you to know tonight that God's getting ready to put some closure to some issues that you've been wrestling with, wrestling in the court system. He's putting an end to it. You're wrestling with your children. He's putting an end to it. Wrestling with your spouse. He's putting an end to it.
Shut her down.
Look at your neighbor. Say, get ready.
Put her in.
You got a bunch of men standing behind her. Y'all better pay attention. You have a bunch of men, they're directly standing behind that woman while she's doing that. All right? Now, we're still playing clips, but then we're going to ask some questions afterwards, okay? Next clip.
Come on, put those hands together. Let's warn the spirit and the wind. For God, you declared in your word that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pull down every stronghold, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Father God, in Jesus' name, we put on the helmet of salvation. We carry the sword of the spirit. We put on our shield of faith, God, and we war in the spirit tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, the name that is above every name, the name by which every knee shall bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And Satan, in the name of Jesus Christ, we bind the works of the enemy. We bind the works of the flesh. We bind the works of the devil. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we come against every plot, every plan, every scheme that has been set forth against the people of God. In the mighty name of Jesus, Satan, the Lord God rebuke you. And we bind you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. For it is written, whatsoever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And Satan, we bind you right now in the name of Jesus. We bind every spirit of poverty. We bind every spirit of lack. We bind every spirit of want. In the name of Jesus Christ, we break every curse that has been spoken against the
life. Shut her down. Shut her down. All right. She's binding everything. And let me say this, you folks. Let me say this to you folks. By no means are we mocking them. We're not mocking them. I'm actually in a state of peril in my mind right now. You have to realize I came from them environments. A lot of us did. And I'm never going back there. I am never going back to that right there. Right there, right, what you're seeing is in a lot of churches across America, across the world. You have the women in emotion and have a heightened sense of emotions, and everybody have some type of rebuke and binding some type of spirit and calling on the name and everything else. And next week they got to do the same thing over again. How come that power didn't just strike that out right there? Yeah. Last night, you know, you got a lot of different things that we were showing, but one thing that should have been showed and it should have shined a light for everybody is that there's an order to things. There's an order, all right? We got more clips. Hey, I know. We got to shine a light on it. Run it.
With everything that's in me, I love him because he first loved me. I Because Tina asked a question. She said, what's love got to do with it? If Tina was here right now, I would say to Tina, before the foundation of the world,
she'd rather be called by God than Michelle Obama. Now, all these women up there, they talking about the Lord and everything else. Their head's not covered. None of that. You know? This is what we're dealing with in a community. Somehow, in these sermons, you're hearing the same stuff over and over again. These are squashed the span of time, different churches. Turn around and touch your neighbor. Touch somebody. What are you talking about?
You know what's really sad about this, y'all? We laugh about it, but let's just keep it real. It is a motivational speech. They're playing on people's emotions, and you know how I don't know if y'all picked up on it, but who's leading the charge?
When they pan out to the audience, you got the women. But let me say this: I'm not gonna say it yet, because the last time when I made that statement, it was a lot of chaos. But I will make the statement probably after these next couple clips. Run it.
We could maybe say, okay, give him a break. Cool it down just a little bit. Can you turn that flame down just a tad? Even if we could, God help me tonight. What did he say? Yes.
And beside all this.
And beside all of this.
Between us and you.
Oh, God. Oh, Yedobaha. Yedobaha. Siki Yedobaha. Yedobaha. He said, beside all of this, there's a what?
Between us and you.
Between us and you.
There is a great gulf.
There's a great gulf. I can't come. But so far. So, rich man, even if we could turn the flames down, and even if Lazarus could, like, you know, throw out some, take a sprinkler, he said, man, beside all of that, read that slowly, there's a what?
And beside all this.
Beside all of this.
Between us and you.
Between your kingdom. And God's kingdom. Between this world and God's world.
Shut him down. Shut her down. Even a man in his spirit, he shook his head. Because, you know, he's like, my God. I don't even know what to think of this. She got her head's not covered. She got the female reader. I mean, I guess they're bringing out what they had to bring out. Run me another one.
comes to spending regular quality time with God. Now, to be honest with you, I can go anywhere in the world that I want to, and I can ask that question. I can do a leadership conference. I can do a pastor's conference. And I had the same response. Listen to me. If there's one thing the devil does not want, it's for you to spend regular time with God. Please listen to me tonight. I'm telling you what, I am so sincere in bringing you this message. I believe with all of my heart, if some way, somehow, God will give me the grace to teach you how important it is for you to give God the first portion of your time and seek Him yourself on a regular basis, I believe that it is the answer to every problem you have. I believe that. I believe it's the
answer. Shut her down. Shut her down completely. She was like, you know, you got to give God your first. That's the difference. You see, the women that's hooping and hollering, yeah, they trying to get that money. You see Joyce Myers out there. She got all those people. Yeah, they got, well, I could go anywhere in the world. The devil, which, okay, you're the devil. He doesn't want you to do this. Who are you talking about? What are you talking about? Who are you talking to? Run another one. This is Christianity's finest women. This is what they are. This is who they are. Come on.
I know I'm with you. Because when you start spending that quality time with God and you start purifying and you start feeding your spirit the word, your discernment goes up and God trains you how to love people from a distance. He trains you how to let somebody embrace you, and you know when you hug them, you're embracing a demon. Something about this one ain't right. I can't put my finger on it, but okay, I'm not getting saying that, but listen. Why is this? Because let's look at the scripture right quick. Luke 8 and 11. Let me give you the meaning. Now the meaning, Luke 8 and 11. Now the meaning of the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Somebody said the seed is the word of God. Say the seed is the word of God. Say it again. The seed is the word of God. It says in the 12th verse, those along the traveled road are the people who have heard. Then the devil comes and carries away the message out of their hearts, that they may not believe, acknowledge me as their Savior, and devote themselves to me and be saved here and after. Now get what that just said. Those that travel along the way, those that just come to church on Sundays, is those that hear the word. And the devil come and he takes the word out of their heart. Why? Why did it just say he takes it? So they can't believe. Now, I'm going to tell you something. That was key right there. So let me reverse that.
That's like a male-ish type spirit. All that stuff sounds like it would be making sense to somebody who's unlearned. Until you really start reading the Bible, you're going, what is she talking about? This is very painful. We got to clear this spirit out. Run, join the force.
Romans chapter 11 verse 1. I say then,
has God cast away his people? people, you so-called blacks and Hispanics, the Israelites, have God cast away his people?
Read, God forbid!
Meaning no, God has not cast away the Israelites.
Read, for I also am an Israelite.
Paul said, I also am an Israelite. That's the New Testament. Read,
of the seed of Abraham, uh-huh, and the tribe of Benjamin.
But God has not cast away.
You got to clear your spirit out. The book of Isaiah, chapter 29. Now we're going into scripts. The book of Isaiah, chapter 29, verse 13.
All right. The book of Isaiah, chapter 29, verse 13.
Come on.
Wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw nigh near me with their mouth.
These people. There's a certain group of people who would be give a lot of lip service. We just played the women of Christianity. We didn't even get to the men, because you get to the men, you probably have to shut down shop. They're just complete madness. But you're saying things about God with your mouth, but the actions is what the Most High is looking at. The Lord is looking at, okay, how are you going to represent the scriptures by applying them, not just by speaking? Read.
And with their lips,
come
do
on,
honor me.
With their lips do honor me, because you seeing it, they get saying they doing praise and worship, everything. Read.
But have removed their heart far from me.
But their mind is removed from me. They ain't breaking down no scripture. How you gonna read Revelation and don't break nothing down, then go into a prayer? You only read it because it had woman in it. And it got everybody fooled. Somebody left that conference. Oh, that was powerful. I feel empowered, but you still in the same garbage you've been in, because you don't know how to change. You don't know how to apply scriptures. If you know how to apply them, you change. To apply the scriptures is actions, not just sitting down going, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. That's not actions. You giving lip service, but your mind, the way that you operate, is not changing. This is the problem. This is why it's called order of the house. Because once you have righteous women, we start going with the white righteous woman. You got to have the righteous man first. He's got to know how to set up the house and establishment underneath the words of the Most High, how the laws, statutes, and commandments govern his life. It governs his gates. Let me thank my husband. Her husband probably don't even care. He should be ashamed of himself for letting his wife do that. Well, they might not know any better, but they know better now, because the Israelites on every corner. Read.
And their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men.
You see that? Turn around and touch your neighbor. God's going to remove this. God's going to bind this. God's going to do that. How you your head uncovered, you ain't doing nothing, but yet Joyce Myers, I need to bind them, all these women. They all have the same pattern and the same spirit on them. Why do you have the same spirit saying, touch your neighbor? That's demonic. Nobody see it, but in Christianity, they don't. And this post is going to be so fire. You brothers get on the comment boards and destroy them. Because here's the reason why. Christianity is a huge moneymaker. The guy on the piano, he want her to keep doing that and keep drawing in crowds, cause so he can get paid. The lighting technicians, everybody in there, they need this to keep going. This is how they get paid. So what do you think happens when we start shining the light on these foolish shenanigans? People start going, well, they make excuses. So the fear toward the Most High is taught by the precept of men. They're not teaching the fear. What's the fear of the Lord? What? Well, let's go there real quick.
The book of Psalms, chapter 111 and verse 10.
Come on.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments.
You see that? If it's the beginning of wisdom, what a man is teaching you, they ain't teaching you wisdom then. Because a good understanding will all day have all they that do the commandments. The good understanding, go, okay, what this scripture shows us is we need to conduct ourselves like this in this particular situation. I'm a thief. The Bible says stop stealing. I got to stop stealing. Simple as that. I'm always out of order. In regards to how I deal in my marriage, the Bible says, oh, I have to be like this. I'm going to conduct myself like that. And then you stand on that and believe on the Most High. Somebody going to be real angry with us because we see even in Israel, you got secret women on Facebook with men names in it. You know, yeah, all kind of stuff. But and they battling brothers, and some of y'all brothers be in there battling and everything else. Don't realize you battling a woman. That's madness. So social media is never the movement. All right. But there's a proper order. We're gonna prove it. Let's go to Numbers chapter 27. Contrary to popular belief, this is not about women pastors. This is about the He-Man Woman Haters Club. I hate men. That's every one of those female, well, you ain't realizing. Every single one of them that's up there think that they have a calling on their life, but in all actuality, if you was to tell them, we'll bring out the scriptures, we see if somebody should repent off of it. But if you don't, what does that show you? Man, they really hate Christ, man. You don't realize that. They really hate Christ. As much as people break the yoke, break it, Lord. Oh, how about you? Shut up. Shut up. That all that stuff they're doing is complete madness. It's madness. You've been doing it for years. You've been doing it for decades. They brung it into us on slavery times. You've been doing it since that period of time. You need to shut it down. It's not working. You got the churches out of order, the men in the churches. If you are in Christianity, you're in the spirit of homosexuality. Now, we will challenge anybody on that. I don't care how you try to grow a beard and look tough, you still standing behind that woman going, you're conquered. You're not more than a conqueror, you're conquered. See what Moses had to say. Come on. They hate Moses too.
Numbers chapter 27, verse 16.
Come on.
Let the Lord.
Let who?
Let the Lord.
Read.
The God of the spirits of all flesh.
Some flesh.
All flesh.
The God of all flesh. Read.
Set a man over the congregation.
Set a man over the congregation. Set a man over the congregation. See, hate the scriptures. Because there is an order, y'all. There's an order. It's a beautiful thing to see. If you look at especially an Israelite woman, she realizes, oh, we're going to rule everything. I don't have to do anything. That's a beautiful position to be in. I don't have to step out there and blast nobody, stand on the stage and click my heels three times. And I don't have to do all that. We trust in the Lord. Read.
Verse 17. Which may go out before them.
Which may go out before the congregation. They're going out before the congregation. The Bible said, let a man be set over the congregation, which may go out to them. Right? Okay. Read.
And which may go in before them.
And which may go in before them to be able to lead, to be able to instruct. Read.
And which may lead them out.
And which may lead them out. When it says lead them out, what does that mean? Show them how to keep the commandments. Show them how to escape sin. Read.
And which may bring them in.
And go out there and gather the fish, which may bring them in. Somebody's going to be so angry. See, they're going to try to bring up Deborah. that's the common stuff that they do to try to escape what Moses said right here. They'll bring her up. When you read in Judges, you're never going to see, and the Lord raised up Deborah.
Yep.
You see the Lord raised up Ehud. Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18, verse 18.
The book of Genesis, chapter 18, and verse 18.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great and mighty nation.
Don't something funny happens even in Christianity? They always go back to Abraham. They love it. Say, Father Abraham, I want to be a friend of God like Abraham. Okay, read.
And all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him.
So the Israelites who are scattered in all the nations, known as different nations, they will be blessed. Let nobody fool you. Well, all the nations going to be blessed. You read all through the Bible, the Lord is going to rule the nation with a rod of iron. He's going to dash them into pieces. How's that blessed? How's that blessed? But that's what they say. They're legitimately saying Abraham is the father of many nations. And all the nations is blessed through Father Abraham. That because they don't know no scriptures. The Lord's going to dash the nations into pieces like the vessels of a potter's clay. Believe that. Read.
Verse 19. For I know him.
For the Lord said, if I know him, read.
That he will command his children.
Sarah going to command them.
He will command his children.
Okay, come on.
And his household after him. And they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment.
Come on.
That the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him.
So the key word is showing you that Abraham is going to lead. He's going to command his gates. He's not going to sit back and be dictated outside of the scriptures from not commanding his gates. It's his responsibility. He has to do it. Now, why is that? Give some. I know we got a mic out there. Let's see. We're going to catch. Let's catch Ezekiel. Somebody give him a mic. Why is it his responsibility to command his gates? Because God, we can't hear you. God deals with men first as the. Hold on. Give him another one.
Because God specifically deals with men first.
Okay, so it's you're saying that it's an order to how the Most High is dealing?
Right.
Okay.
I mean, God chose Abraham to
okay
be the progenitor and all the blessings.
The progenitor, all the blessings. Because somebody going to get mad because they're going to say, well, no, God's just not dealing with men. We know that, but when it comes to order and establishment, especially in a household where it's a man and a woman and he's married to that woman, go to Ecclesiasticus chapter 36 and verse 24. Ecclesiasticus chapter 36 in verse 24.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 36 and verse 24. He that getteth a wife.
Come on.
Beginneth a possession.
The Bible is showing you when you go and get a wife, you beginneth a possession. Oh, here go the ladies. You don't own me. You don't possess me. read that part again.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 36 and verse 24. He that getteth a wife beginneth a possession.
Beginneth a possession. So the woman that you sisters out there that are not married, you have to be very, very cautious, because if somebody now comes to find you, you have to make sure, oh, this person is the right one, because he's beginning a possession. This man is now will be, if you choose to go to that level, you have now, he's your head. You have to follow his direction. This is why we say to a lot of sisters out there, it's a shame. They get married to men and their husband go off into complete madness. They go bye-bye too. You don't realize that?
Go ahead. Hey, Rob, can you go to, Genesis 3 and 16? I mean, because this line up exactly with this scripture that we just now read. Also showing the order of the house. I mean, the order of the house, you know, yes, it goes. I mean, it can cover two things. It can goes into marriage, man and woman, and the order of the house also goes into the church, the order of the church, showing you who, you know, just like the elder was just showing in these scriptures, who, you know, who the Lord set over the house. The Lord set the man over the house is the man that's responsible for leading, for teaching, you know, protection, all of that. Because if somebody was to come up in my house, break up in my house, I darn sure won't want my wife to stand there and try to fight, and I'm standing behind her like, get her. You know what I'm saying? It's my job as that husband to protect and be the one, you know, to protect that house. But I'll read Genesis 3:16 real quick.
Genesis chapter 3, verse 16. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee.
Mm. All right, so the scripture says, unto the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children. We know what, you know, sisters go through bringing forth kids. That's that sorrow. That's near death. And it says, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. When the scripture says he shall rule over thee, that doesn't mean that, you know, he's that lion in the house and said, woman, you do what I tell you to do. Or, you know, how, you know, you got some brothers, how they treat sisters in some organizations. You know, they treat women like crap. But like the scriptures just showed us how that woman is our possession. When it says, and he shall rule over thee, the scriptures is showing you how we must teach that sister, how we must take care of that sister. That's what it means by he shall rule over thee. When it says he shall, it says, and thy desire should be to thy husband, showing you that that sister should want that man to be that protector, to be the one that teaches her and to guide her in, you know, in spirit and in truth. Mm. So that's what the scriptures is going into right there.
It's sad because some ladies don't really want that, but they just want all the other amenities that go around that, but they don't really want that. They don't really want that desire, thou desire should be to your husband. They don't really want that. They like, thou desire should be towards America. Go back to Ecclesiasticus 36. I mean, at the end of the day, he that getteth a wife beginneth a possession. So now that rule that you have to responsibility of your gates, you need to make sure that you are doing that which is the most honorable and responsible thing to build your gates up, which is to follow the commandments. Some brothers right now that come into the truth, your gates is completely out of order because you woke up and your wife didn't. It's out of order. You can't come to us, because a lot of times somebody goes, I get these emails all day. It's like, yo, Well, oh, let me tell you this story. I came in. See, I see the truth. I'm in this. But her, she's not really in this. She do some things. I mean, she do, don't get me wrong, she good. I don't know, what? Excuse, what? She good? What are you talking about? But, you know, she just not good with the scriptures. But she good. But she just not good with the, with, you know, doing certain things. I said, well, what are you talking about? Well, she still go to church and preach on Sundays. All right. Make you feel like a hypocrite, don't you? Oh, yeah, it does. Well, you have a decision to make, sir. That's what I was calling about. So what? Oh, no. We will never make that decision for any man, because you'll be the demon. You'll be the fool to do that. You'll be the fool to do that. You have to let that's between, this is my exact answer to everybody. That's between y'all and the Most High. You got to work that out. You know how much patience you have given. You know how much, you know, things is happening. You know who's rebellious. You know what's going on. Mm-hmm. If you know all that stuff, you make your decision and you stand by it.
This is what that brother don't understand. This goes for all of us, men and women, of course. When you go to the book of Ecclesiasticus, chapter 27, verse 3, This is what this brother have to understand. Because first of all, what has happened, he's lost the essence of the scriptures, basically what the order is and who set the order up. See, We didn't set that order up. See, that's what people mess up and they think, oh, it's just about men just trying to rule over everything. No. What it is, is the Most High sets an order. Everything is done in decency and in order. And this is what you have to understand. So we go to Ecclesiasticus or Sirach, 27 verse 3, it tells you something.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 27, verse 3.
Okay.
Unless a man hold himself diligently in the fear of the Lord.
Mm. See, unless a man hold himself diligently in the fear of the Lord, what must happen?
His house shall soon be overthrown.
And that's what can happen. Once you go into the fear of the Lord, you're going to understand that she can't preach. You're going to understand that the Lord set up a heavenly order. So once she understands, once he shows that, and she had to see it for herself as well, this is what has to happen, because your house will get overthrown, because the Most High can judge you straight up.
Go back to stay in that book. Back to chapter 36, verse 24.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 36 and verse 24. He that getteth a wife beginneth a possession.
Read.
A help like unto himself.
Just like we went back up in Genesis. We're going back there. We're going to show you what happened with Eve when she got the same prideful demon to speak to her. Because the same incidents happened even back in the beginning. You supposed to be a helpmeet. If you're a woman, you can understand, okay, I got a husband. He's my head. I'm going to be a helpmeet. I'm making sure we work together. And, you know, we're going to make sure we do this according to thus saith the Lord. Not according to thus saith Satan. Read.
And a pillar of rest.
And she's supposed to be a pillar of rest. What's a pillar? What is the pillar of rest? Uriah. If a woman got to be a pillar of rest, boy, if only thing we could do right now, we would hand that mic back there to some of them ladies, they would be wanting to go in right now. Give them the other mic. Got it? Okay.
Shalom. Most High in Christ bless. Happy Sabbath. I'm not quite sure.
You're not sure what a woman's, when it says a pillar of rest? Okay, that's okay. Mm-hmm. You're single. Let me get to one of the married guys up over there. No, I don't need a married person. I don't need a married person. Chiz, go ahead and help us out.
Shalom. a pillow of rest. Basically, that woman is supposed to be kind of like his backbone in a way. Like, she's supposed to help him with managing things. She's supposed to be the...
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah. In a way, she's the one who kind of like calms things down. Of course, he's supposed to be leading the household, and because she's his wife and she's doing things righteously, she's following right after him. So everything that he's going through, I mean, she's going through it with him. So they're kind of in it together. So she's being his pillow of rest by, I don't know.
Help him out, Minister Nathaniel.
Shalom, Mosai, Christ bless. So a pillow of rest, what that woman is supposed to be is that meek and quiet woman. Whereas when you're in the house, you maybe come home from going out doing the work. She is there, you know, to help maintain the house while you may not be there. When you're probably going through some trying times, she's there, you know, you talk to and everything like that. But she's not a lion, like a devouring dragon in the house or anything, to where she is just going off the top. Every time you go in the house, you just have no rest whatsoever. You don't know what's going to happen because she's just a tornado, you know, that's a path of destruction. But a pillow of rest is a person, is a wife who is in the house, is quiet, is tend to her business. That Titus, you know, 2 woman, Proverbs 31 woman, where it's virtuous. She knows her role, she know how to submit, and she know how to follow her husband, as thus saith the Lord.
That's right. Look like we got another married person want to speak. Pass it back to Mike. Notice I said another married person. Okay.
Shalom. A pillar of rest. A pillar is something that's stable. It's something that's stable that you can lean on, and it's not gonna move. It's rooted. So, like, when you read in Proverbs 31:11, it says, the heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. So that pillar of rest is going to be somebody that you can safely trust in. Like, you can go out and do the works and not worry about her being shaken and thrown in the wind by every wind of doctrine that come at her.
Perfect. So if you think about it, as I mean, y'all broke it down perfectly right. If you look at a man that's married, he does not want to come home to a lady who's consistently going to be worse than what he was dealing with on Esau's job. You know, and that's some brothers have that dragon in the house, because you can tell, because all they want to do is they just be like, yo, man, you going to go home? Nah, man, what is it? No, never want to go home. Man, what y'all want to do? Man, I'm going home. So I'll find somebody else. Yeah, you just sitting down consistently at Kickback Jacks and all kind of stuff. You with all the single bros. Every time the single bros go out, you're with them. You must not want to go home. All right. But the pillar of rest, you're like, nah, man, I'm going home. I'm just going to chill, you know, try to ease my mind off of the day or whatever the case may be. That would be somebody who you're looking at is like, okay, that's great. That's a virtuous woman. That's a woman that you want to be around. You do not want to be around a woman who consistently, when you come in, she's sucking her teeth. She's fixing her little head wrap, getting ready. She got, you know, her shoes on, all kind of stuff. She's ready to get it in. You're like, me and you going to fight when you get home. It's people like that. I remember I was working at a job. It was an Edomite came up to me. He was married to a sister. I said, when he saw me, well, I wasn't in the truth at the time, but now that I look back on it, he came up. He said, came up to me, had his little phone. He showed me the little message. I said, man, I said, you going to go home? Because the message was just so out of pocket. I said, you going to go home? He said, he wasn't that smart. Because in the message, when I read, I said, whoa. She's saying some crazy stuff on here. He said, yeah, I don't know what this is. He went to the next message. He showed it to me. He said, what does that mean? I said, bro, that look like to me that word says animosity. He said, what's animosity? I said, bro, if you go home, it's going to be problems. I said, it's going to be problems. I wasn't in the truth. I didn't give him no righteous counsel or nothing. I was like, man, you might want to have, you know, some backup or something before you go in there. You know, yes, off the chain. Another incident, if he's watching this, he knows that it's the truth. At this side breaks out. This is like right before I came into the truth. I lived in Vegas. It was wild. It's crazy over there. But we sitting at a casino. All the bros come in town because they're like, yeah, we got a spot to stay at now because it's Vegas. You out there. So they come in town. I'm like, yeah, come on with me. We going to hang out. We going to do everything we can do. We out here. So we in the casino. I'm sitting at a slot machine. It's a Subway right there. Boys come in and everything. So, man, why he keep coming? Why does he always come here and do this? So he's now speaking to the Subway lady. He like, man, we got free sandwiches. I'm like, what's going on? He said, yeah, I've been, you know, every time I come here, man, that's my girl right there. I holler at her, whatever the case. I said, man, I ain't going to call her name out. I said, what about, you know, the other one? I said, she don't look like she can handle something like this if she find out. Man, as I said that, I turned around. She was right there. And after I watched all the melee happen, because it was bad, but I will never step in anything domestic, I said, man, we need to get out of here because you're going to go to jail. Because, you know, it was a lot of stuff happening. Anyway, the police stopped us. They looked at his face. She had scratched this man's face up. I'm talking about real bad. And the police stopped us. They looked at us. You know, you do anything in Las Vegas, they bring you to jail. Well, that day when the police stopped us and looked at him, they said, you've been punished enough. That's how bad he was gouged out. They said, I was driving. They said, I was like, sir, I don't know what happened. I'm trying to go home. Man, he had, you know, retarded strength. Let's just put it that way. He picked that girl up and dropped her. But that goes to show y'all something. But that goes to show y'all something. What you don't realize outside of the truth is everything is in disarray. It's you doing what's in your own mind. But what's spawning it, we've watched these videos. These people will be in these conferences and at church believing what they're saying. In the next Sunday, they hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. But not applying it, you still fall into chaos week in and week out. But for the man who has who knows how to conduct himself and running his gates in order, he gets his possession. Read on. Let's find out what happens. If he don't take care of that possession, we're going to find out what the Bible says happens to him.
Ecclesiasticus. Chapter 36 and verse 25. Where no head is, there the possession is spoiled.
So, what is the hedge? Christ, the scriptures, the way that you conduct yourself, you can put a hedge around that possession. You can have that. That can grow beautifully. But where no hedge is, what did the Bible say?
The possession is spoiled.
So what was the possession? The wife, right? If you don't put the hedge there, it says the possession is spoiled. Now, that don't mean that you don't have a long marriage. You got a bunch of people in chaos that have been married 50, 60 years. That don't mean that. What it's showing you is that for you to have something in order according to the scriptures, to be able to produce something that's godly and righteous, you have to conduct it how God says. Or else it's not righteous. I don't care however long you've been married. Read.
And he that hath no wife.
And he that hath no wife. So It can get so bad that that possession, the Most High remove it out of your life. She's removed. And he that have no wife, read.
Will wander up and down mourning.
Will do what?
Wander up and down mourning.
Will wander up and down mourning. The Bible is a true book. The Bible is a true book. So the possession gets spoiled. Now your wife end up packing up, leaving you, or whatever the case may be, because you've been a beast, man. You wasn't teaching. You wasn't doing nothing. Now you walking up and down. So she left me. She took my favorite chair. And forget about thinking you're going to go to court. This man gonna do you. Read it again.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 36, verse 25.
Come on.
Where no hedge is, there the possession is spoiled.
Come on.
And he that hath no wife will wander up and down mourning.
So, you brothers that are married, man, you better make sure you teaching your gates. Make sure you have a little notebook or whatever the case may be. And you probably give it to your wife and be like, okay, we're going to break down. As I learn, I'm going to just break down whatever I know. Here you go. Oh, I just learned this today. Here you go. Write it down. So we're on one accord. That just brings everybody on one accord. Nobody's in disarray. Nobody's going, oh, I don't know what this is. Now, we've been saying that for years, but some of you brothers never do it. Well, you can't. Who's you gonna be? Who's the blame? If your possession is spoiled, then you're the blame. Because when you read in this book, a wicked woman is given as a portion to a wicked man. That means you're allowing the wickedness. Therefore, you're wicked. Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16. Don't be wicked. But now you have a different element starting to arise. The Most High's not dealing with that shenanigans, and you have a bunch of men leaving Christianity at alarming rates. If so many people leaving Christianity, if so many men leaving Christianity, it's not even funny. Just getting up. And look, you might be the brothers that's, you know, standing out there, you know, at the little conferences and all this other stuff. But know this much. Take your time. You learned your Israel. You're just learning. You're getting your spirit together. You know, keep building on that righteous spirit right there. Don't have a relapse and fall back into Christianity, because that's what happens to a lot of people. They come out knowing, okay, I'm Israel. Then they have a relapse. And what they want to do, somebody's trying to call a school line. You have a relapse and you fall backwards into trying to do what you've done in Christianity. That's a failure. All those old things, you got to let that stuff go. Start learning. You got to be retaught. Learn Christ all over again. Because what's happened is, in Christianity, they gave you the emotional, the Christ that you want to cry. Mm-hmm. You know, he just did so much. Mm-hmm. They give you that. Yep. But once, after you get that, then what does that turn to? There ain't nothing wrong. Remember, last night we didn't say emotions is tears or anger. We say when you go outside of the scriptures, that's emotional. Read.
Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 16.
Come on.
Bind up the testimony.
So the Bible say bind up the testimony. Who's the testimony? According to what scripture? Revelation 19 and 10. Put that in your notes. Read.
Seal the law among my disciples.
Seal the law among my disciples. Seal the law among my disciples. Y'all highlight or bracket off that word right there. Seal the law. Seal the law. It's going to come in handy in other classes. Seal the law among my disciples. Come on.
Verse 17. And I will wait upon the Lord.
And we're going to do what?
And I will wait upon the Lord.
Come on.
That hide it.
Go to wait upon the Lord is to have faith, is to have trust, not do what they keep doing week in and week out. Grab your neighbor. I bind the Satan. I bind everything that's touching your pockets. Well, that would be you. You're touching my pockets too. So you bind yourself. You just bound yourself. Read.
That hideth his face from the house of Jacob.
So the Lord hideth his face from the house of Jacob. Hide it. So you're seeking now. And if you're seeking, you're seeking an identity. That's what it is. That's why he say, seek my face. Read.
And I will look for him.
Come on.
Behold, I and the children whom the Lord have given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel.
You see what it's for? Signs and wonders in Israel. So you have to pay attention to the signs and wonders. There's signs and wonders happening all around us all, every day. Come on.
From the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion.
Now, one of the signs and wonders that y'all really, a lot of people didn't pay attention to right now, you have a place called Christ Church, New Zealand. We're going to run the clip for you. Christ Church, New Zealand. You had a spot there that's called Christ Church Mosque. Does that make any sense? Christ Church Mosque. The mosque. The mosque. Christ Church Mosque. And you show the map where New Zealand. Some people going, New Zealand, what's that? It's right below Australia. Now, we was discussing a little bit earlier. What a lot of folks don't realize about Australia is that the so-called white man shipped over 100,000 convicts over to that place. Go back to the picture. Go back to the picture. The so-called white man shipped over 150,000 convicts on that land, Australia. Right there. Do you realize that? You don't see nothing wrong with that. You don't see nothing wrong with that. He just say, oh, you know what? Take all the people in the prisons, people that we don't want over here, we're going to ship them over to Australia. What made them choose that? Why'd they go, okay, send them there? Show New Zealand. Those are Japhites over there, y'all. It's for another topic. It's for another topic. Somebody going, well, who are they in the Bible? They're Japhites. So New Zealand. Think about another clip of a mosque.
A massacre streamed live online.
Let's get this party started.
His name is Brenton Tarrant. He's 28 from Grafton. He has an arsenal of guns and he's about to kill dozens of people. He drives to the Our Nua Mosque in Christchurch and playing the battle song of the British Grenadiers.
Pause it. Started from the beginning. But I want y'all to pay attention to stuff. I'm going to have you pausing it every so periodically in here. Come on.
A massacre streamed live online.
Let's get this party started.
His name is Brenton Tarrant. He's 28 from Grafton. He has an arsenal of guns and he's about to kill dozens of people. He drives to the Our Nua Mosque in Christchurch and playing the battle song of the British Grenadiers. He calmly parks his car in a laneway next to the mosque and then reaches for a semi-automatic shotgun. The mosque is full of worshippers. He opens fire from outside. We are not showing what unfolds next. But for several minutes, he walks through the mosque, shooting repeatedly. This man hid under a bench and survived.
The blood is spitting on me, splashing on me. And I'm thinking, oh my God, it's going to happen to me now. But fortunately, I'm alive and praying to God, oh God, please, now let this guy run out of bullets.
Tarrant walks outside and then opens fire in the street.
It went on about 6 minutes or more, and I could hear screaming and crying, and I saw some people were, drop dead.
Back in the car, this time, a pump-action shotgun. He tries to shoot out his windscreen. He opens fire again through the passenger window.
He would have a, like, you know, the big gun, okay, and a lot of bullets, you know, okay. And he came through and he started shooting like everyone in the mosque, like, you know, everywhere.
As he weaves through traffic, he then coolly describes what he has done. You can hear an ambulance rushing to the scene.
There wasn't even time to aim due to so many targets. And there were so many people that the car park was full.
Christchurch spun into lockdown. School children warned to stay inside, heavily armed police on the streets, a stream of ambulances, and hospitals overwhelmed by multiple casualties. This couple dropped their son off at the mosque and don't know where he is.
And I haven't heard from Tariq at all. So, and I appreciate there's a lot of other people who haven't heard as well. So, I don't know. It's just very difficult.
Christchurch felt like a war zone.
We are pouring resources into that area. Every available Canterbury and staff member and people nearby, other emergency services also.
Does that couple look weird?
Saturating that area.
The first shooting took place at the Al Noor Mosque on Dean's Avenue before a second shooting at the Linwood Mosque on Linwood Avenue, nearby Christchurch Hospital, as well as schools across the city. A beige Subaru was later rammed by police on Broome Street, around 2 kilometres from the Al Noor Mosque. Tonight, all mosques have been told to
shut down. Shut them down. I don't think people realize the difference. The Lord... Who authorized that is the Lord. Oh, yeah. The Lord authorized that. But you have this guy who's from Australia, but those are the offsprings of all the convicts. And then he goes over down to New Zealand at a Christchurch, New Zealand, at a Islamic mosque, and he opens fire, but he gets pumped off the a British song. You can't even make this stuff up. Don't you see what's happening in the world? Don't you see, realize what's going on? You got to realize what's going on in the world. And you got a chance right now to repent, and you still following after madness and foolishness? You have a chance right now to, you have a chance right now to go, okay, you know what? I need to get lined up right, because the Most High opening up judgment. But yet you still don't want to get right?
You know, when I see stuff like that, a scripture comes to mind. And this is what a lot of people in Christianity would never understand. Because when you look at Islam, it's still Christianity. It's the same thing. I mean, because it's a religion. See, that's what we keep trying to tell everybody. This isn't a religion that we're in. This is our heritage, and we keep the commandments, right? When we go to the Sirach or Ecclesiasticus, 33 and verse 1. Because we don't, this is one thing we don't have to worry about. Why? Because the Most High does what? He puts a protective hedge around them. And we're going to show you what that means. So Ecclesiasticus chapter 33 and verse 1.
The book of Ecclesiasticus chapter 33 and verse 1.
Go ahead.
There shall no evil happen unto him that feared the Lord.
You know what the Bible says? It says, there should no evil happen to him that feared the Lord. When you start keeping commandments and doing what is righteous in the eyes of the Most High, he will have a protective hedge around you. Go ahead.
But in temptation, even again, he will deliver him.
He will deliver you from them temptation as well and from danger. You see, because understand something. In Christianity, I would say, oh, the law's done away with. You don't have to keep the commandments. Right? But go ahead, verse 2.
Verse 2. A wise man hateth not the law.
A wise man don't hate the law. Because once we start keeping commandments, that protective hedge is going to be around us. But go ahead.
But he that is an hypocrite therein is as a ship in a storm.
That's what these doctrines are. A ship in a storm, because it doesn't have no root in it. Tossed to and fro. You see? I just want to bring that little point out.
All right. Well, let's go to stay in that book, chapter 39, and verse 14. Let's make it, matter of fact, go to verse 19.
Okay, Ecclesiasticus, chapter 39 and verse 19. The works of all flesh are before him.
Come on.
And nothing can be hid from his eyes.
Nothing can be hid from the Most High's eyes. Remember, his eyes is 10, 1,000 times brighter than the sun. Read.
Verse 20. He seeth from everlasting to everlasting.
Come on.
And there is nothing wonderful before him.
There's nothing that can, make it seem like to the Most High, like, I'm shocked. No, the Most High is causing all things. That's why it says nothing wonderful before him. It's nothing that you can go, that the Most High can see that go, I didn't know that was going to happen. He's ordaining it. Read.
Verse 21. A man need not to say, what is this?
Come on.
Wherefore is that? For he had made all things for their uses.
Come on.
His blessing covered the dry land as a river.
Come on.
And watered it as a flood.
Come on.
As he have turned the waters into saltness.
It called it his blessing. It's calling it his blessing. Keep that in mind. Read.
So shall the heathen inherit his wrath.
So that's, he said his blessings, but he said a heathen's going to inherit his wrath. Who's that a blessing to then? God, only Israel. The heathens are going to inherit his wrath. Watch this. Read.
Verse 24. As his ways are plain into the holy.
As his ways are plain. We look at it, we go, the Most High set forth judgment. That's why a lot of you brothers, man, and a lot of sisters don't understand, especially when we go, stay out of the way of that.
Yep.
Don't get involved with any of this. You don't realize the Most High, as he looks and goes, wipe out everybody involved with this. You will be caught up in it. Now, why we should just say this. Oh, yeah? Go ahead and get involved with it. Watch what happens. Stand back. The Most High. Once the Most High's sight is on something, you can fall in the midst of judgment. Read.
So are they stumbling blocks unto the wicked.
But it could be stumbling blocks to the wicked. They don't understand it. But read.
Verse 25. For the good are good things created from the beginning.
So for the good, good things are created from the beginning. The Lord know who's going to repent. Read.
So evil things.
So are what?
So evil things.
So evil things. Come on.
For sinners.
Come on.
The principal things for the whole use of man's life are water, fire.
Come on.
Iron and salt, flour of wheat, honey, milk, and the blood of the grape, and oil and clothing.
Blood of the grape is wine, oil and clothing. These are principal things that the Most High has created for men to take part in, for you to enjoy. Read.
All these things are for the good to the godly.
So a godly person look upon it and say, well, all praises to the Most High. He allowed, me to even sample these things. Read.
So to the sinners, they are turned into evil.
But to the sinner, they turn to evil. Like what the United States has done is they put the woman up there. They keep the Israelite man silent. Let him shut up. Let her be up there and preach and do everything else and stay in an emotional state of mind while all around you, men is all around you producing other chaos. You sitting back, Call of Duty, LeBron James, Dallas Cowboys, Redskins. Bet you mad Packers. Hey, think about this. Read.
Verse 28. There be spirits that are created for vengeance.
Just like you see that guy doing that, Most High created spirits for some people. His whole existence was made to go do that. It's spirits that were created for vengeance. Everybody going, that's so horrible. It's horrible. But remember, to the godly, somebody looking in plain like, the Most High just set forth judgment on Islam. And who does the Most High use them on the nations, you nations out there that watch this program, you may comment. You're very ignorant. You have not realized that what the Most High has done is use the so-called white man to strike fire on people. It don't matter if it's Hiroshima. It don't matter if he in a war with the Nazis, who they call the Nazis himself. It don't matter who it is. When he waged war, he played for keeps. See, this man, like, he ain't expect to go nowhere. I'm going to shoot my front window out. I'm going to shoot the side window out. Pow. pistol grip pump. Let me write my name on it. And he counting. It was crazy because, you know, I was shooting so many bodies. He's on Facebook Live doing this. I mentioned last night when at the time he's doing this, Facebook's supposed to be down. You don't realize they're day ahead. It's Sunday over there right now. Yeah, so Wednesday for us was really Thursday for him. For them, he's on Facebook Live, pistol grip pump. Read.
There be spirits that are created for vengeance.
Come on.
Which in their fury,
read.
Lay on sore strokes.
Sore strokes. I would not show the video because I have the video. I've seen it when he came in. A lot of people saw it, but I wouldn't re-show that video. I'm not going to show people getting gunned down. That's not righteousness. This man's the devil. But you got to realize that there's no hedge. They're in idolatry. And it's mass people in it. If you showed you the so-called white woman was with so-called white woman looked like a so-called Japhite. They together talking about we sending our kid to a mosque. In Christ Church, you got Islam over in New Zealand. What's going on? You got Christianity over there. What's going on? Like, why did they bring that stuff over there? And you don't think that the Lord is looking at all places? You can't hide. Read.
And the time of destruction, they pour out their force.
At the time of destruction, they pour out their force. Just so happened his force was a couple of pistol grip pumps. Read.
And appease the wrath of him that made them.
So that was some folks don't realize the wrath of the Most High was upon it. Then he pulled his wrath back and just let those who are wise look at it and go, uh-oh. Not to fool with him. Because at any given time, the Most High could have just decided, you know what? Get rid of that whole little island of New Zealand. Just blow it up. Cause an earthquake. Do something. Send a tsunami over it. Read.
Verse 29. Fire and hell and famine and death.
Come on.
All these were created for vengeance.
You hear that? So as a watchman, as a person who's looking, and as a family, as a wife, a husband, a sister in the truth, a brother in the truth, thinking about coming together, you have to really understand to do this in order. And that order causes, you got to really start to not only look at even your husband for ladies, as he got the spirit of Christ on him and he can lead. But for brothers, you gotta really prove that you have that spirit on you. You got people in the comment boards last night. Somebody's in the comment boards. I need a wife. Excuse what? Don't let me delete that brother quickly. We're not the people like that. Guys, all the time, it's a whole, you sisters, some of you sisters know already because you send me the screenshots. Elder, I don't know how to say this, and I hope that I'm not out of order. This is me texting back. You know, I said shalom. Here come the screenshot. Boom. I'm not going to even say it. But anyway, you know the famous opening lines. Yeah, it's the queen. Most High and Christ bless. Notice that you wear great head wraps. Notice that, you know, you're very modest. I'm wondering if you can speak, you know, I'm trying to come correctly. So if you can speak to the elder for me, you know, I'm trying to do this right. Can you please speak to the elder? You know, I would love to, you know, start to get to know you and all this other stuff. My response, sis, why did you just send this to me? Why are you sending this? It just seemed like it was, it seemed like it was random. Yes, it is random. It is random. It is. somebody saying they like your head wrap and all this other stuff. People got to get, you got to get to know somebody first. Because it's very important. It's critical. It's the Most High setting for judgment out here. You want to be the person that can build your house up. That's why the question to every one of you sisters that are not married, are you trying to build or are you trying to tear it down? Because even the married sisters, you got to ask yourself that question. Why are you not asking yourself that question? Am I trying to build or am I trying to tear down? Because those ladies that we just watched, they ain't building really nothing. They building Caesar. And they building their own thing. You know, I'm so glad God got me out here, you know, buy my book. Read verse 30.
Ecclesiasticus, chapter 39 and verse 30. Teeth of wild beasts and scorpions, serpents and the sword, punishing the wicked to destruction.
So even when you see the animals let loose, sometimes the Most High send mountain lions, serpents, snakes, all kind of things. Those animals get a command to do that from the Lord. If they don't have you don't ever realize if y'all watch the animal channel or whatever the case may be, and they give you those close encounters, it's sometimes animals walk up to people and then go, oh well, I'm not destroying them. You just walk off. It was a man, a bear ran up on a man, stood up 9 feet. He just standing there like, I know I was dead. He got his little GoPro on, nothing. The bear looked at him, not right now. Okay, I guess he's spared. Go about his business. Like, I don't know why. But those animals, read the next verse.
It says, they shall rejoice.
What does those animals do?
They shall rejoice.
Those animals rejoice, read.
In his commandment.
When the Lord give them the commandment, lay sore strokes. Ah, thank you. About to tear them up. Now, we can prove that in the Bible, but that's for another topic. We can prove it. The Most High have, I tell you to stay here. You keep moving. Okay, you want to listen. You don't listen to the Lord. Go about your business. Send a lion on them.
And the lion, what the lion did was it killed him, but didn't eat him.
Right.
It was just used just for judgment.
Straight up.
Just because the man of the Lord, what he did was he was disobedient to the Lord. He was just used for vengeance.
Straight up. Didn't even eat him.
Then when he passed by, the lion was just sitting there with his corpse, just sitting there.
Happy at the commandment.
Happy.
Read on. Even animals are happy at the commandments, but you devils are not. Read.
And they shall be ready upon earth.
Come on.
When need is.
When need is. Come on.
And when their time is come, they should not transgress his word.
When the time comes, they ain't going to say, they ain't going to even think twice when it's time to lay on the sore strokes. You understand that portion? Go back to Isaiah 8. Oh. Verse
18. Isaiah. Chapter 8 and verse 18. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord have given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel.
Come on.
From the Lord of hosts which dwelleth in Mount Zion.
So as the Israelites starts to put out the understanding, showing you the signs, the wonders, the different things, the signs and wonders also is how could you go into captivity? You will now become a sign and a wonder yourself. Come on.
Verse 19, and when they shall see, and when they shall say unto you, seek unto them that have familiar spirits.
This once again, a lot of people take familiar spirits and they use it to say that these are people who are doing witchcraft, like seances and stuff, which is true. But you don't realize those people in Christianity have familiar spirits on them? Why you think every one of them telling you to touch somebody? That's not normal. That's all across the, everywhere we've been at in these churches, they're doing the same thing. They got spirits on them. Mm-hmm. And then they, you know, have the same verbiage of how they speak. All the same huffing and puffing. You don't think that's a devil? You start walk up to somebody. You in the church, you never know it because you was a zombie. You was completely out of your mind. You never knew it, but you just sat there like everybody else and was like, wow, she giving it her all. Or he giving it all. And he just, and a lot. Read.
And to wizards that peep and that mutter, should not a people seek unto their God?
Should not the people, instead of going to see somebody in regards to how to get to God, shouldn't they really start seeking? The only way you could do that is reading the Bible. This lady read Revelation 12, a piece of it, and just went into an emotional prayer. Read on.
For the living to the dead.
Come on.
To the law.
Come on.
And to the testimony.
Come on.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
I got another clip. I know I didn't want to do it, but I must do it. Run it, gang. Hold on. Pause it before you run it. So, we know to the law and to the testimony, you got to speak. The Old Testament and New Testament is in perfect harmony with each other. It doesn't contradict or anything. We know Christ is the testimony, all right? So none of this is odd to someone who's an Israelite who's doing this. You know the light is the law. Now, the reason why we're running this clip, this is not going to be too bad for y'all. Not going to be too bad. But what I would love for you to do is to pay attention to what he's saying. Even though this is madness, but pay attention to how they operate. Let's run.
Pearson shattered. Only on 2, Pastor Carlton Pearson will tell you that Tulsa is the city of his prime and of his crime. His ministry was a sudden and bright supernova before it burned out in a spectacular crash that left Pearson shattered for straying from the story as it had always been told.
But with the release of a new movie that documents his fall, Pearson tells 2 Works 2 anchor Scott Thompson he's never felt healthier, happier, or holier, with a powerful second chance at finding a new kind of spirituality.
Things that I feel like God has called me to do is bridge gaps, not only between cultures and nations and denominations and people, but generations.
20 years ago, Carlton Pearson was a bright and shining shooting star, arcing across the sky of Pentecostal preaching.
You know what I'm talking about.
A suave, sparkling skyrocket of a man who mesmerized Tulsa's powerful evangelical community.
Got that old school.
Rises up inside of you.
I lived that way. I had mastered the craft of it.
And a close friend of your parents.
A protege of Oral Roberts, a graduate of his university, he ministered to 5,000 followers.
A protege of Oral Roberts, the father of the prosperity doctrine. This man they came up with that prosperity doctrine, and that's what sent everybody into madness. Because at the end of the day, that's how they feed the people. They tell you that you're going to get a blessing, but you must sow a seed. And if you go into church, you already have some type of emotional problem. I'm going to say it that way. You're already detached to some level, and they just tap into that. If you just got 1,000 people out there, you can keep going. Somebody in here is low on gas. Somebody got to pay their rent.
What?
Somebody need to breed. He talking to me. Read, watch, go back to him.
Every Sunday at his Southside Higher Dimensions Church, and with his Azusa conferences to standing room crowds at the Mabee Center and the Downtown Convention Center.
I knew what to say over the pulpit. I knew what words they needed to hear.
Thank you,
Thank you for coming.
He was a regular guest on global Christian television, and because of his serious polish, he began appearing on mainstream TV, whose bookers saw him as a legitimate voice rather than a sideshow curiosity. He was named a regent of the ORU Board of Directors, counselor to presidents, part of the National Healing after the Murrah Building bombing in 1995. And though Carlton Pearson seemed to have it all,
I kept feeling unsatiated, unsatisfied, and I didn't know why.
He became bored with everything he built.
It became tasteless to me. Didn't taste bad, it just had no taste at all.
And so restless and questioning as he approached his 50th birthday 15 years ago, Pastor Pearson began to listen to that which had been stirring inside him.
I came up with the conclusion that we probably got it wrong. And we misinterpreted that.
I came to the conclusion that we probably got it wrong. Let's see what's going to happen in Christianity.
Instead of the Bible being the inspired word of God, it's probably just the inspired word of man about God.
He began to preach inclusion, that everyone goes to heaven, and that there is no hell.
I just couldn't reconcile in my mind eternal torture, weeping, wailing, gnashing of teeth. It didn't make sense. And my experience of God was not that way.
But in turning his back on a spiteful and angry God, he unleashed the wrath of what he calls Christianity.
See what he just said? Turning his back on a spiteful and angry God. That's how they look. In Christianity, they look at the Old Testament like that. They say he turned his back on it because he's trying to reconcile in his mind. What folks don't really understand about this guy right here is he realized something ain't right about Christianity. So he's trying to figure it out. Like maybe everybody just goes to this place. You know, everybody not going to hell or whatever the case may be. And a lot of you folks out there, you know it's the truth, but you're trying to save nations. You're trying to save people. And you can't reconcile in your mind that the Israelites are going to be put on top. This is why it's important to have order. It's important, all right? Let's see what they're going to say. Come on.
Christianity Incorporated. He was suddenly a mortal threat to the business of the Bible.
And so when something happens that threatens the community or the doctrine or the dogma or the tradition or the cult.
The
belief,
business of the Bible. The business of the Bible. Yeah, rewind it. And he called it a cult.
It's the community or the doctrine or the dogma or the tradition or the cult belief. Everybody gets defensive.
His fall was to be quick and complete.
Some people just turn away from you. That's painful, but it's more bitter when they turn against you.
Other pastors began to attack. He was barred from Oral Roberts University and removed from its board. And its namesake, his mentor, the creator of the prosperity gospel, warned him that preaching inclusion would destroy everything.
What they say Oral Roberts was? The creator of the prosperity doctrine. Why come they know this stuff, but our people don't? No, they're not listening at all. They love entertainment. That's the person that gave them the blueprint. Gave them the blueprint. Come on.
They built. He was declared a heretic and would lose his home and his friends.
I baptized those people and counseled them and prayed with them and gotten some of them out of jail and been to the bedsides when they were there when they were dying. And I just didn't think that covenant would ever be broken.
And as his congregants at Higher Dimensions began to flee, leaving him unable to pay the mortgage, he lost his church.
I just didn't think that would happen. But when it did, that's when I knew, wow, this is big and this is bad.
I want to ask you something.
It's his story of loss and redemption that's told in the movie Come Sunday, a sleeper hit of last month's Sundance Film Festival. Taking part in its production has been both cathartic and painful.
And did you love it?
Here we go again. A movie will come out. There'll be critics. My name will be used. The people who are angry at me will become angrier. The ones who love me will love me more.
And though a public mea culpa could get it all back and more.
I've had millionaires come up to me and say, if you change your message and go back to what you were, I'll buy you the property, I'll buy the building. We miss you, we need you, we want you as you were.
And when the devil knocks you back,
he says that Carlton Pearson is dead.
We love you at All Souls.
The reborn one, the newly energized one, is the Pastor Pearson who makes monthly Sunday visits to All Souls Unitarian Church in Tulsa. And the one who can now reach hundreds of thousands around the world from his living room with Facebook and YouTube messages. Messages he hopes that offer a new perception of God for the 21st century.
Shut him down.
Check, check. And real quick, just like you all heard, he's still speaking another doctrine. He said the Unitarian. And one thing that you know, they teach universalism, all will be saved, all nations will be saved. That's another dangerous doctrine. So, I mean, I can't say he went bad to worse. He's still in the same, you know, in the same spot.
It's sad because he's searching, and now he just basically ran into a brick wall again. But it shows us, without that structure of following Christ in the keeping of the commandments, you just go fly away and doing whatever you can do. It's a problem, okay? But so how do we get rid of this problem? You get rid of the problem by the Most High setting back the Israelite man in his proper order and then having him to go and teach. And the first teachings that he do is within his gates. The first thing that you do is you make sure your gates is in order. The first thing you do if you're single, make sure yourself is in order. Before you start going after these women and everything else, because it's going to cause a problem if you're not. And those, and the one thing about it too, this is to the brothers that's, you know, maybe have wives or whatever, they don't see it or whatever case may be. You can never let them see that you're a hypocrite. Because if your wife see that you're a hypocrite, you're a person who's a hypocrite, like, yeah, around brothers he's like this, but then when all the brothers leave he's like that, you're finished. You just stay home. You're done. Because you're not really in this. So, and the ladies know that. Them ladies know how to snuff out people so much because they had so many guys talking to them anyway. They be spotting stuff like, oh, that's what he trying to say? Okay. And only when you get the woman gets emotional and she gets gullible is where she makes mistakes. But if you really sit back and think about it, you should be a helpmeet. The woman should be a helpmeet. So, okay, well, you know what? Let me build him up. He's supposed to be like this. Okay. But for whatever reason you have, especially in the truth, you once you come in this, you can never be a hypocrite. Never. You just be who you are, man. You gotta follow these commandments and put it forth. And if you do, then it can all pan out in righteousness. If you get in that situation where somebody's going, oh, you know what, the woman you're with, your wife, is like, oh, I don't wanna even be a part of this, then you have to sit that person down and let them know, hey, you know what? The decision you're making right now is going to tear down this house because I'm fully resolved in doing that which is righteous. I'm fully resolved in it. Why is that such a bad thing? It's only bad when a man gets emotional. You go, I can't, man. You know what? She's a good person, though. That's the mind state. She's a good person. She's a good mother. You know, good wife, she's this and that. Bruh, slow down. Is she still doing Christmas? Yeah, she is. I can't make excuses for her. Is she going to do Easter Sunday? Yeah, oh, yeah. She already got all the kids' outfits picked out. What do you want me to do? Bruh, we can't tell you what to do. You haven't worked that out. You have a situation right now. Let's switch it to the woman's side. Because the Bible show you how to conduct yourself. You might have to separate. The woman's side, you're in the same boat. You got a husband that's doing all kind of things and drugs and doing things. You got a problem. You can't be like, have everything around that. You got to make a decision. But you can't wait for somebody to give you that decision. That has to be embedded in you. You gotta understand that. Now, here's the order. We read it all the time. Go ahead.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. Be ye followers of me.
Come on.
Even as I also am of Christ.
Come on.
Now I praise you, brethren, that ye remember me in all things and keep the ordinances as I delivered them to you.
This is the order. Come on.
But I will have you know that the head of every man is Christ.
Come on.
And the head of the woman is the man.
That's, we read that. The husband's going to have rule over you. So you, the head of the woman is the man. They don't like that. If you don't like it, then you have a problem with Christ. Mm-hmm. You don't have a problem with us. Read.
And the head of Christ is God.
Remember, when we was at the shack.
Mm-hmm.
We was in the shack, and some women came in. I know Jake remember it. The lady came in. She had her whole little. Let me use the old school word. She had a pocketbook. She had her pocketbook, big purse. She sat down right in front too. Boom. The lady was like straightforward, like, yeah, okay, let me make sure this is this and that. So, okay. So the message went out. She got up and she was like, I feel
a lot of masculine spirits up in here.
Yeah, that's what she told. She said it's a bunch of masculine spirits in here. She started trying to prophesy to us and stuff.
No, I don't think it was.
Jake wasn't on. Jake, that might have been like at least 2 months before you came. It was bad, though. Yeah, she started speaking in tongues. Yeah, and this when you have sisters that's really in the truth, they like, oh, we about to get her. She's speaking in tongues and stuff. Well, let's get the scriptures out.
1 Corinthians 14. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 14.
Yeah, run, go there real quick. This is what she got hit with. No, she wanted. Matter of fact, class was going out and she was trying to interject in the class.
Yeah, she was saying stuff, you know, out of her mouth during the class, but we kept looking at sis. You had to be silent.
Yeah, a couple bros just looked at her and just did her real dirty, like, shh. Shh.
Right.
Be quiet. Yeah, even kid child, yeah. Even a child is known by his doing. The dog went, shh.
But you know what's funny? When you read this chapter, Christianity, mind you, they're all about the new covenant, right? They're all about the New Testament. But why can't they understand this? 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I'm going to go to verse 2. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him. Howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. Okay. But he that prophesied speak unto all men to edification and exhortation and comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself. Shabba dabba do, I love you. But he that prophesieth edifieth the church. I would that ye all speak with tongues, but rather that ye prophesy.
And these tongues is known languages.
Yes.
Come on.
For greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh with tongues, except he interpret.
So you're supposed to have someone who can translate. You know, I have another brother who might be Spanish. We watched this happen before. All right. But the point is, in this same chapter, we'll pick up the spirit behind it. In the same chapter, jump down and read verse 34, because it's in the same chapter. We just watched it on the screen.
1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33.
Kill me if we don't read 33.
For God is not the author of confusion.
And this is where it really breaks down, because you got some Old Testament folks that try to use this scripture. You don't even believe in the New Testament, but yet you saying God is not the author of confusion. Where's that found at? Read.
But of peace.
Come on.
And in all churches of the saints.
Saints of the Israelites. Come on.
Let your women keep silent in the churches.
So, that's an epic failure. We showed you all that. It just said, let your women keep silent in the churches. You're going to have to give me the exegesis on that, brother. You're going to have to put that in the right context. Read it again.
Let your women keep silent in the churches.
Why?
For it is not permitted unto them to speak.
It ain't talking about a woman coming and sitting down in a congregation and can't say shalom or hi, how you doing? This is literally talking about leading a congregation, standing up before, which may go in before them, going out to them, standing up there. Here, take the mic, sis. You got it. And the Lord said, oh, holy glory. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. The Lord gave me a word this morning. Okay. Let the woman keep silent in the churches. It just means for them that they cannot come up and give elevated speeches talking about, oh, I'm going to lead you in this or that. Read.
But they are commanded.
Come on.
To be under obedience.
Come on.
As also saith the law.
But did Paul write this?
Yes.
Why are he talking about the law if the law is done away with? Read it again.
1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 34.
Come on.
Let your women keep silent in the churches.
Come on.
For it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience.
Come on.
As also saith the law.
As also saith the law. They are commanded to be silent. They're not commanded to lead a congregation, go out before them. All right? Read on.
And if they will learn anything.
And if they will learn anything, what has to happen?
Come let on. Them ask their husbands at home. For it is a shame for women to speak in the church.
What?
For it is a shame for women to speak in the church.
These people don't believe in the Bible, man. These folks don't believe in the Bible, man. Here's your main person you follow, Paul, is telling you, be silent. Let the woman be silent. The main person. And you see this spirit running in these churches in Christianity all up in America. This is the same spirit that's running right now. But Paul's saying, be quiet. Read on.
Verse 36. What? Came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only?
What? Came the. Who is he talking to right here? The woman. What? He's telling. What? Came the word of God out from you? Or came it unto you only? Somebody help me out. Nathaniel, help me out. Somebody get Nathaniel the mic. Because this is a real statement right here. We made the reference about Deborah. The Most High sent deliverers, then raised up deliverers, then she came. Try that one.
Test. All right, so 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and 36. All right, it says, what came the word came the word of the Most High out from you, or came it unto you only? So it's saying, what is this not permitted, or is this not discerned for you? are you, is this not, like, for example, if, is this not being said to you that it's, that you don't have to obey this? You're set aside from this, but everybody else have to obey it besides you.
Right. You got to realize that. So it's orders to this. It's a holy government. It's a holy order. Things going to be done decent. Let all things be done decently and in order. This whole chapter, it's got to be done in order. It can't be done like we just saw up there. Let's say somebody speaking some type of, say somebody speak the holy language. This is the Most High pour the Spirit on somebody. They actually literally can communicate and speak the holy language, the holy tongue. And then no one's interpreted. Is that in order? Why would the Most High give it to you then? He gonna put you out of order? Shouldn't somebody else arise right there? That don't make any sense. But that's because the order of the house is all mumble jumbo. Folks are doing things by what they saw. Nobody never showed you that, you would have never done it. This is why there's a setup. There's a business. There's a setup behind it. And no matter how much you think in your mind, you trick yourself up to believing that setup is correct, it don't make it right. Go back to 1 Corinthians 11. Verse 3.
1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3. But I will have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man.
Come on.
And the head of Christ is God.
Come on.
Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonoreth his head.
So if somebody used that logic, because women do that, they'll say it's talking about hair. Then I need to shave my head bald. And then, of course, we know in the scriptures that's against the commandments. You can't shave your hair bald. So that's epic failure number one. Read.
But every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered.
Uncovered? What you mean, uncovered? She have no hair? What are you talking about? Read.
Dishonor her head.
Who's her head? Her husband. So that's why the lady's supposed to have the heads covered. So this lady up there saying, you know, I just thank God for my husband. Her head not even covered, going over scriptures, everything. The importance of that is the Bible says, he that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Why would you follow that? Oh, see, I see we got a commenter. Let me see what's going on here. We sometimes set it aside. Somebody, Mark Forthofer. Oh, my goodness. Sir, I might not even answer his question. Can you explain why there are so many contradictions in the Bible? Like what? Oh, wow. Okay, I see something here. Hang on. Go on there. Pull up some of his little snapshots. Gosh. So somebody can't say we're showing a lot of hatred or whatever. It might be on my main page. It's on my main page. So don't go on Minds. Open up another tab and go on Minds. Just hit my name. Sometime my page is madness. Scroll up. It's in there. Mm-hmm. Go in the comments. You see the comments? That's okay. Yeah. You see somebody named Mark? Click him. Let's give him his due propers. Oh my gosh, let's click onto his picture. Go to the other one. No other way. Go ahead. Oh my gosh. All right, click out of them. Never mind. We know, sir. Go to his web. Yeah. Well, number one, there's no contradictions in the Bible, but we know why you feel that way, because look what he's doing. I mean, he's spiritually handicapped. Go to another video, man, real quick. I think I got one more video. This is what happens. Now, warning, we showed this earlier, but this is what happens. You got a person like Mark. He's wondering why the Bible has contradictions and everything. No, Christianity has contradictions, because the so-called white man brung that doctrine in and caused a lot of chaos. And now he's ruling the earth behind that same principle of that ideology that he brung in. And it caused a lot of chaos. But it's going to come a day and age where your weapons will not work. And this is going to show you something right here. Go ahead.
And more and more people that move into the city. For it. Just got dispatched to a domestic disturbance where a male is chasing a female down.
A domestic disturbance where a male is chasing a female. Just look at him. Now they done dispatched him over there. He's dispatched over there. Come on.
On the street, and we're just around the corner. We're gonna stop by, yeah, right here. Go and check out and see what's going on with these guys. What's going on?
I ain't got nothing to say to you.
Ooh. Sit on the curb. Sit down on the curb.
What?
I'm not gonna tell you again. Sit down on the curb.
And what are you doing? Don't be grabbing on me. I just asked.
You're gonna get tased if you don't sit down.
I ain't getting that to you.
Nothing.
I'll get you, bitch.
Oh!
Get on the ground.
Oh! Yes. Man, tased this man with 50,000 votes. Didn't fade him not one bit. You realize when your weapons is not going to work, this man has still had a cigarette in his hand. Getting tased. Nothing. Nothing. Imagine when this man's weapon don't work. He's finished. You hit this man with 50,000 votes and nothing happened to him. But if he was in his true power, he realized, man, they can't even stop me with your little puny weapons. That's the guys behind even the officers, America, and everything else. They show up. He put his hands on this man. Man, you don't have an authority to put your hands on this man like that. He's a grown man. Running back again. Somebody's in a disbelief. That moment you get your spiritual power.
Go and check out, see what's going on with these guys. What's going on?
I ain't got nothing to say to you.
Sit on the curb. Sit down on the curb. I'm not going to tell you again. Sit down on the curb.
And what are you doing? Don't be grabbing on me. I just asked.
You're gonna get tased if you don't sit down.
I ain't getting that to you.
Nothing.
I'll get you. Get on the ground. Yeah. Turn around. Turn around.
Fast forward him, man. We'll show you how the devil lies. Mark, this is for you. This is how the devil lies. Keep going.
Away from him when the police.
Right there.
And take me downtown, man, and let's get the
What's your name?
You grab me when I ask you. You ask me a question and then you grab me. You put your hands on me.
What's your name?
You disrespected me as a man, so I ain't got nothing to say to you. Just shut the door and go about your business.
All right, here's the deal. Right now you're under arrest for obstructing. You have the right to remain silent.
Man, I already know my rights. Go on with
you. You have the right to presence of an attorney. If you count an foreign attorney, one will be appointed to you by the courts. Do you understand? Do you understand your rights? Do you understand your rights?
What you gonna do, grab me again?
Yes or no? Woo. Yes or no question. Do you understand your rights?
In the spirit.
Got nothing to say to you.
Watch how he lied now, y'all.
What's up, DB?
And I grab him to escort him down to the ground. He pushes off from me.
So, what do you got?
Right now, we got obstructing.
What?
So, but.
Okay. Are you okay?
He's not.
Did he swing and did he hit you or?
I don't remember if he swung at me, but when he pushed off, because I was going down to get the taser and calling out.
So he pushed you?
He's like this.
So we got battery on an officer kind of pushing or?
Yeah.
They're trying to set him up with battery now on officer.
Pull him down like that and he does one of these.
Okay.
What?
Listen. Y'all just saw something with your own eyes. And who is this guy, this Mark guy? Because we want to show him, if there's a contradiction, explain this. Let's go to the book of Habakkuk, chapter 1, verse 1. I'm going to show y'all something. See, this is something that's on camera. But remember the things that's not done on camera. Now, that man, that Edomite straight up lied. The man ain't do nothing. The man was just sitting there. The man asked him a question. And he rolled up on the man with hostility. You see what I'm saying? The man didn't even come at the officer like that. But let me show you something. Let's go to the scriptures. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 1.
The book of Habakkuk, chapter 1 and verse 1.
Uh-huh.
The burden, which Habakkuk the prophet did see.
Habakkuk sees a burden. As y'all see, it's a burden to see something like that. Go ahead.
Oh, Lord. How long shall I cry?
Oh, Lord, how long should we cry injustice? How long should we march? Oh, Lord, how long should we cry? Go ahead.
And thou will not hear.
Uh-huh.
Even cry out unto thee of violence.
You just saw violence, right? The violence that's been done, unarmed so-called blacks and Spaniards being shot down constantly. It becomes desensitized because what they do, they use propaganda to do what to demonize you. So when stuff like that happens, it's no big deal. Go ahead.
And thou wilt not say, why doest thou show me iniquity?
Uh-huh.
And cause me to behold grief.
To be grieved, because you're going to be grieved in the spirit if you see something like that. Go ahead.
For spoiling and violence are before me.
Spoiling and violence is before us. Every time you turn around, it always ends that way. But go ahead.
And there are that raise up strife. And contention.
That was contention. The man came in there with a spirit that he was going to contend with that man. Because he didn't ask, he didn't see, he didn't hear the conclusion of the matter, nothing. Mm-hmm. He already prejudged the situation. Rolled up on the scene. Then he's going to lie at the end and say, I don't know. Maybe he might have hit me. I don't know. You know if the man hit you or not.
Right.
Go ahead.
Therefore, the law is slacked.
What's slacked?
The law is slacked.
Because he's going to take that to the judge and fabricate a lie and say this man is obstructing. The man didn't obstruct anything. If anything, he was obstructing him. Go ahead.
And judgment doeth never go forth.
Judgment never go forth. The righteous judgment, the righteousness of the Lord, the righteousness of what? Of the justice, they say, the justice system is never going to go forth. Because that man can sit there and fabricate a lie on TV now. Fabricate a lie. What was he obstructing? You have to know the law. You see? It's amazing, but go ahead, though.
For the wicked doeth compass about the righteous.
Uh-huh.
Therefore, wrong judgment proceedeth.
Wrong judgment, because what's going to happen, they're going to put that man in court, fabricate some lies, trump up some charges on the man, and have a charge on his record. He's obstructing justice. The man won't obstruct nothing. He was just sitting there. Assault on the officer. The man, if anything, they're assaulting him. Amazing, isn't it? So where's the contradiction there?
Go back to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, We got someone that needs us to explain verses 3, 4, and 5.
Okay.
3, 4, and 5. Let's do it. Mm-hmm. Let's do it slowly.
1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3. But I will have you know that the head of every man is Christ.
So our head, who we follow, who we are under subjection to, is Christ. We can't just bypass Christ and go directly to the Most High. You're crazy. Everything we do, we have to go through Christ, period. Mm-hmm. He's our head. How we conduct ourselves, how we make peace with the Most High is through him. Read.
And the head of the woman is the man.
In the same fashion, when it comes down to leading spiritually, when it comes down for him to lead his gates, the woman cannot usurp him and skip over the man. She cannot do that. She's got to make sure she's on equal accord with her husband and she's following his instructions. In no way you can get around that. Come on.
And the head of Christ is God.
And the head of what?
Then the head of Christ is the Most High.
You see that? The head of Christ is the Most High. He's not doing anything outside of the order of what the Most High said for him to do. It's not outside the order. Come on.
Verse 4. Every man.
Every man who's Christ is our head. Every man. Read.
Praying or prophesying.
What praying or prophesying means is that you're speaking the name of Christ. You offering up blessings. You doing anything that you are referencing Christ. If you say the Lord's gonna, you'll just prophesy. If you say I'm praying that the Lord, you're sending up prayers. If you say, you know what? Most High in Christ bless you. You are now saying, may the Most High bless me. That's a future prophecy. So you have to really understand anything you have to deal with Christ. For as a man, we cannot have our heads covered. Now, why is that so important? Somebody, hold that thought. Let's go to the book Ezekiel. Yeah. Remember? Yeah. Yep. Ezekiel. Was it 21? 26. Oh, go ahead, Nathan.
The book of Ezekiel, chapter 21 and verse 26. Thus saith the Lord God, remove the diadem.
So a diadem, a diadem is a head covering, a crown, a mitre, however you want to call it. So we remove that because of Christ, right? We can't have our heads covered. Read.
And take off the crown.
Take off the crown. We got to wait to be crowned. Like when you go up into the Apocrypha, it's witnessed that this tall man is passing out crown. He's greatly admired. So this tall man passing out crowns, Christ. Come on.
This shall not be the same.
We can't. That holy attire in Ezekiel's being shown, it shall not be the same. That's not going to be the same. Why? Read.
Exalt him that is low.
So the high priest used to wear it as well, but now Ezekiel say, exalt him that is low. Exalt him that is low. Who's low? Christ came low, man. Christ came at the most humble level. He ain't come put the crown on my head. I'm the leader. No. Came low. Read.
And abase him
that is high. And put the person abased that's high, like a high priest. Now Christ is the high priest. Read.
It will overturn.
What did he say?
I will overturn.
I will overturn. Showing you that system, how it was set up, the Lord said, I'm going to overturn that. Read.
Overturn. Overturn it, and it shall be no more.
You see that? And it shall be no more. So when you're following the Bible, we're following the whole book. You understand? Go back to 1 Corinthians.
1 Corinthians, chapter 11, verse 4. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonor of his head.
You're dishonoring Christ. As simple as that. Read.
But every woman
that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered dishonoreth her head.
So to have your head uncovered, not to put something over your head as a woman, you dishonor your head. Now, what you don't realize, if let's say if a woman doesn't have a husband, your head is the father, like we read last night in when we read in Numbers, because he's basically the one that can set forth that vial or whatever the case may be that a person had made. If you don't have a father, then it would be the elder that you have to make sure, because it said treat an elder as a father. So you still got to cover your head. If you have a husband, for sure you know that you're supposed to cover your head. So overall, the order of it is to cover your head. Now, where does that play out at? Numbers chapter 5. Let's go there. Numbers chapter 5. Start at verse 12.
Numbers chapter 5, verse 12.
Start at verse 11, because they think this our words.
Okay. Numbers chapter 5, verse 11. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying,
come on.
Speak unto the children of Israel.
So the Lord is commanding this. Read.
And say unto them, if any man's wife go aside and commit a trespass against him, and a man lie with her carnally.
Literally, this woman step outside of her marriage, step outside of her husband and deals with another man, read.
And it be hid from the eyes of her husband.
What do they call this? Creeping? Okay, I'll take that one. Affair, they call it that, but come on, y'all. Somebody said it. Adultery. But it's hid from her husband's eye. Nobody saw it, you know? To keep it in closet. Read.
And be kept close.
Come on.
And she be defiled.
Come on.
And there be no witness against her.
Come on.
Neither she be taken with the manner.
No, like, it just like, no, nobody knew it. Nobody saw it. The husband don't know nothing. It just happened. And now it's just, she's there. She done got, you think she got away. But there is an ultimate power. Read.
Verse 4. And the spirit of jealousy.
And what happens?
The spirit of jealousy.
Come on.
Come upon him.
Then the Most High then sent forth a spirit of jealousy on the man. So the Most High put spirits on you now to realize, hey, man, she done did something. She done stepped outside of the marriage. Read.
And he be jealous of his wife.
Come on.
And she be defiled. Or if the spirit of jealousy come upon him, and he be jealous of his wife, and she be not defiled.
Because something could have be something, because nobody don't realize this. You don't supposed to be sitting down with another man's wife, talking about I'm going to lunch with you and spending time. You got some married women and single bros that will sit down and play video games together and all kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Talk about, oh, that's my best friend. What was my friend when I came into the truth and all this other stuff. Okay. Oh, before the truth, she was my friend and, you know, this and that. All right. But that you start develop some type of close relationship and the spirit of jealousy jump on the man. Nothing happens yet, but it's very close to happening. So the spirit of jealousy will come upon a person and go, ah, something wrong with this picture. It ain't right. So the husband will start to have these feelings, that's why we call feeling spirits. Now he got spirits on him. Read on.
Verse 15. Then shall the man bring his wife unto the priest.
Come on.
And he shall bring her offering for her, the tenth part of an ephah of barley meal. He shall pour no oil upon it, nor put frankincense thereon.
This is for another topic, but pay attention to those things that the Lord is saying what he needs to do. Read.
For it is an offering of jealousy.
Come on.
An offering, a memorial, bringing iniquity to remembrance.
So the Lord is going to bring iniquity to remembrance. But remember the components that it just said in there? You can read this somewhere else where the Lord is going to have jealousy and judgment is going to go forth, because sins will be brought back to remembrance. Jake's looking like, what? I know it's somewhere. Read.
Verse 16, and the priest shall bring her near and set her before the Lord.
Pay attention now. This is the point. Read.
And the priest shall take holy water.
Come on.
And an earthen vessel, and of the dust that is in the floor of the tabernacle, the priest shall take and put it into the water.
Come on.
And the priest shall set the woman before the Lord.
So now she's before the Lord, because if you're before the Lord now, what has to happen if you're a woman? Read.
And uncover the woman's head.
So before, when she went there, her head had to be covered. Now, because it's a shame, it's something that's being brung out, that's an embarrassment, they uncover her head. Do you understand that? When she went in there, her head was covered. But because it's some type of embarrassment, it's some type of spirit of jealousy, take that covering off. Yeah, you ain't holy. Something's going on. The order of the house is not right. Uncover her head. Read it again.
And the priest shall set the woman before the Lord and uncover the woman's head.
So her head was covered. Now it's uncovered. Come on.
And put the offering, a memorial, in her hands, which is the jealousy offering. And the priest shall have in his hand the bitter water that causeth the curse.
Bitter water that causes the curse. That should highlight that. That's for another topic. But either way it goes, I don't have to read it. Go back to 1 Corinthians. Okay. Bitter water that causes the curse. All right, and the woman's head was showing you prior to her walking in there, she knew she had to have her head covered to sit before the Lord. They uncovered her head afterwards. Come on.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 5. But every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered dishonoreth her head. For that is even all one as if she were shaven. For if the woman be not covered, let her also be shorn. But if it be a shame for a woman to be shorn or shaven, let her be covered.
So if you walk up in here as a woman, because the glory is your hair, if you take a razor and cut your hair off, it's kind of a shameful thing for some women. Esau made it to where it was some type of statement of revitalization or pride to shave your hair off. No, it's not. The Bible is showing you that hair was given to you for glory. But still, you need to cover your head. Head. All right? That's the point. That's the point. All right? If not, he said, let you be ashamed like you was a bald-headed woman. All right? I mean, it's the scriptures. There's nothing we can do about that. Go to Genesis. Genesis chapter, we done ran out of time. Just go to chapter 3, verse 1.
Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtile than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, have God said ye should not eat of every tree of the garden?
Why he asked her that off the gate? Number one, why he go to the woman first? Number two, where is Adam? Mm-hmm. He's the weaker vessel. He not ruling his gates. Read. This going to have to be really a, probably going to have to do a, the serpent in the garden or something.
Yeah, the serpent in the garden would be real good. Show how it correlates today.
All right, well, the book of Acts, chapter 5 and verse 29. Guess you're going to have to wait for it. We ain't going to even have no time to really do it. The book of Acts, chapter 5 and verse 29.
The book of Acts, chapter 5, verse 29. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we are to obey God rather than men.
Well, Lord's will, we'll hit that topic. we're going to follow the Most High's orders, instructions, and everything rather than following man. Come out of the madness of Christianity. Come out of following women. If you are a man and you are in Christianity, come out of the spirit of homosexuality and all kind of stuff. You are in a feminine doctrine. You got to come out of that, all right? Come back to following Christ and get your feet in this war, man. This is a spiritual war. It's a spiritual battle. I don't care how you look at it or whatever the case may be. You got to come back to following Christ in the keeping of the commandments. There's no gray area there, all right? And we give all praises to the Most High in Christ for allowing us to go over the scriptures a little bit. Lord's will, y'all, just count down the Passover.
Oh, yeah.
Looking forward to seeing everybody come through. It should be very exciting.
Right.
All the details and stuff will start to get put out. You guys have to reach out. If you're coming in town, you have to reach out. You got to reach out, all right?
Purim is this week, too.
Yes. I'm going to put the picture up for that, too. We got Purim coming. Uh-huh. All right. Mordecai's Day.
Mordecai's Day. It's not a Sabbath, though.
Not a Sabbath.
Not a Sabbath, y'all. But it's a feast day.
I think it's the 20th.
The 20th and 21st.
20th and 21st.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, it's going to be black. We'll have that meeting, too. So, but y'all keep continually sending up the prayers, all right? Lord's will, we're getting the emails. We're working on some things next level to bring out this truth. As you can see, they shut Facebook down on y'all folks. They shut Facebook down. So that kind of stuff, we're trying to eliminate that. This is why, you know, the brother Akim and the brother Yaron, they're working, on the website.
Right, right.
To get that up and running.
All praises, man.
Yeah, get it going so where we can shift everything over to the website and we don't have to even worry about that type of madness on that level right there at least. Right. All right? We give all praises to the Most High in Christ. All Y'all praises. Continue to read the Bible. Just because the class is over with, you can still read the Bible. It don't make no difference, all right?
That's right.
All praises to the Most High in Christ. All with that, praise. We say shalom, y'all. Shalom.